And yeah. I get to coach. I'm on the track from 10:30 till 5 o'clock every day.
In perfect 75 and sunny weather. Exactly. You were saying that you enjoyed your time in Wisconsin, but like what made you actually choose Wisconsin over some, you know, California school? Because, I mean, you were a 7'4 high jumper in high school. Like, you probably had your pick of any school.
Yeah. You know, Mark Napier was the coach at Wisconsin. He's now the director of track and field at IMG Academy down in Bradenton. Oh, okay. And nice. Mark was the coach there. He came from Blinn College, and Mark can sell ice to Eskimos. I mean, he can do a good job. And he attacked two things that were important. One, he talked to my parents, and my parents are very, me being adopted from Korea. Sure. I was very close with my parents, and part of it, my mom is from Lombard, Illinois. So, you know, being a couple hours from Chicago area, and then my dad's from Syracuse, New York. So, you know, kind of harder chiseled, you know, people. And, you know, I'm half Black, half Korean. My parents were white and stuff like that. And my, in Wisconsin, my high school, we only had 24 Black people out of 2000, you know, high school. So when I went to Wisconsin, it felt very much like my high school.
Okay.
And then, I mean, we won the Triple Crown every year I was there, except for my senior year. I think we got second.
Okay.
We finished fourth at nationals, at NCAAs, and it was the, you know, we built a legacy there. And and my degree was molecular biology, and that was like one of the top programs in the country for that.
Okay.
And I also did a degree in nutrition, and so it was an easy decision from a academic standpoint, coach standpoint. You know, I struggled just, you know, being from Southern California to go like I did. It took me, I think, until my junior year till I jumped 7'4" again.
Oh, man.
And it just was, you know, little things, like things that coaches need to think about, which is like, I remember the first day of practice at Wisconsin, we run about a half mile, three quarter mile out to the track, do the warm up and all that. And I go to coach, I'm like, dang, that was a hard workout. That was the hardest workout I've ever done. And my coach is like, well, that's just the warm up. And I'm kind of like, oh crap, I'm in trouble. And so, you know, just that transformation, that adaptation, and coaches got to kind of sometimes think about that, is that you got to know the training age, you got to know the athlete. Even though I was a 7'4" high jumper and I was very successful, I did very little work. I mean, I played basketball in the fall and then came out to jump, and then we high jumped. I mean, I remember Tuesday practice was I would jump 7 feet in practice and then call a day. I mean, it might be 15-20 minute practice. And then, you know, the other days, Tuesday, Thursday, I would like do approach work for the long jump and maybe do some relay handoffs or something. I don't know, but I was never on the track for more than an hour, hour and a half. And here my warm-up's like an hour long. And so the little things like that, you know, coaches in college have to understand that there's adaptations that have to occur for the athlete. And so, and, you know, being so far away from home and, you know, different avenues like that. But I learned a lot, and really Wisconsin molded me into the coach and the success I've had today as a coach and an athlete. And so it is. There's something about Midwest people that just tend to be a little bit more hardened. Good kind of like blue collar work ethic, kind of things, and they appreciate things a lot more, and I think that's kind of me. I mean, we didn't have a lot growing up. We weren't broke. We weren't like, you know, I had to eat government cheese or something like that. We just had enough, but at the same time, I also had like a paper route, and I had to, you know, clean cars and, you know, mow lawns and do all those kind of things, and I had a job since I was like, you know, 12 until I left, and it was just taught me values and taught me, you know, the dedication it took to be a good athlete. And you know, post-collegiate, I stayed there as grad school, and I stayed there and jumped 7'6" and finished second at indoors, and I think seventh at trials in 2000. And kind of, you know, and then I knew that I wanted to coach because I was still supposed to do pre-med. And then I was like, well, let me coach. And so I was supposed to be a GA, but I ended up being a full-time coach at Cal State Northridge. And I was there for 4 years, and, you know, we had multiple national champions there. We won conference every single year. And it just, you know, it was kind of like, not to be a savant, I don't want to be braggadocious like that, but coaching came very easy for me, but it's not that I just kind of rested on my laurels. I also was like educating myself. You know, I was got my CSCS. I got my USA weightlifting certification. I got level 1, 2, 3, did 3 level 2s, you know, got my IAAF certification and all that when I was at Northridge. Yeah. So it was intense. I mean, it was a great learning experience, but also a time where I was going to educate myself to be the best coach besides getting a master's in exercise physics and biomechanics too. Right. So it was like all those things. My Northridge years was probably the number one for building the foundation of my coaching.
So what made you, how old were you when you started coaching then properly?
So it was crazy. I mean, Ed Nedicombe, the longtime successful coach at Wisconsin, he gave me a word of advice and he said, hey, if you're going to be like this GA administrative system, whatever, you got to stop hanging out with the guys. Like you're with us now. You're on the other side of the thing. Yeah. So it's funny. I'm sitting there and I'm with my teammates and I stopped hanging out with them. I stopped partying with them. I stopped, kind of whatever, because I was on the coaching staff now, you know, and it was crazy. I just kind of scissored it. And then I was 24 when I had my first job. And I think it being a, you know, a 7'6" high jumper and being however many time All American kind of gave me a little bit of kind of respect with the kids, even if they were 23 years old and I was only a year older than them. And I wasn't one of those, like, you have to respect me because I'm your coach. It's like, I felt like even from the point of now, you know, the respect is earned, even though my resume is what it is. And I've coached over 15 medalists, you know, I still feel like it's like, I'm not trying to gain your respect. It's just, you know, I earn it by my actions and what I do on a daily basis. And, you know, how I guide you from a different standpoint. So,
and I think from afar, like as an observer of you, you know, I never met you until today. Like, I feel like I could tell that about you just from watching your videos, you know?
Well, yeah, I appreciate that. And I mean, and that's, and there's transformation that happens as a coach, you know, and there's education. So it's like funny, I was watching one of the elite coaches and he was getting on with someone online about something. And it's just like, I laughed because I was like, I remember when I used to do that too, you know, and I just don't do that anymore. Like, you know, people can comment and say whatever they want. And I just don't get into it with them because, you know, there's no purpose on it. Because once you're in the trenches and once you understand how hard it is to get athletes to any level, whether it's to get them to, you know, the conference championship and them score, or whether it's become All-American or become a national champion or become a USATF champion or become an Olympic gold medalist or whatever it is, everything is difficult and hard, and you can't, you know, and so there's a lot of coaching and teaching that goes with that. And as you get older, you understand that, like, no, I couldn't do that better. Like, I can't sit there, and Nick Peters is a good friend, and sit there and say, oh, I could have coached Dendy better by doing this. As a young coach, I might have thought that, but I understand how much work Nick did to get that person to that level. I'll never sit there and say, like, okay, yeah, I could have done it better, because he did a great job of getting him to X to there. And, you know, and they work hard together to get to whatever he's done. And, you know, and so you learn that respect of being in the trenches and understanding it, and you just don't get into it with people. And people can have their opinions. They're allowed to have them. You know, they're neither, it doesn't mean they're right. It doesn't mean they're wrong. They're just their opinions. And, you know, you get to kind of almost like this plane of enlightenment as a coach, where you're just like, hey, I have enough to worry about with my group. I can't worry about other people.
For sure. For sure. Especially at that level.
At any level. I mean, even if it's high school, I mean, I don't think anybody's out there trying to do the worst job they can. I think they're trying to do the best that they're trying to do.
And that's why it's good to have people like you out there who are, you know, sharing your experience and knowledge, and, you know, through your new product, MBA services, like giving people as many resources as possible so that they can do a better job or do the best job they can.
And that's, and it's came, it's kind of my opus, but it came from just years of, you know, I mean, I started coaching education as far as like actually taking a class in 2001, no, 2000, sorry, 2000. Yeah. And I think my level one came in either 99 or 2000, I want to say. I think it was like Chris, maybe right after the first of the year in 2000, 2001. And I, you know, it took me till like, I want to say 2005 to finally complete all the old way the system was. You had to take 3 level 2s and then write an article, and then you got your level 3. And that's how you got your level three. So I did it the old way, where I took three level twos. I did the throws, the sprints, and the jumps. And then I don't know why this opened on my page, but then I sat there and you know, it just, for whatever reason, it happened that way. And then you progress, and now you could take like an IAAF level five, level three, and then you get your level three certification. So it was much harder back then to get that, but it was great because you learned a lot through it. Right. Mm-hmm. But the point I'm trying to make was I did that. And then in 2006 or gosh, six or seven, I started teaching. You know, and it
like,
was
like in a schools, you mean?
In like I started teaching level ones, I started teaching
twos.
Sorry, through coaching education. Started teaching level three. So it was like from 2006 or seven through 2000, basically 18 or 19, I was teaching coaching education, writing, rewriting curriculum.
Right.
You know, writing. I literally over in the fall, I rewrote level three education for world athletics for long and triple jump. And so,
no big deal.
And I taught, you know, and I teach, I was teaching at, you know, the Cal State Northridge, I was teaching in the kinesiology department. And, you know, I was teaching online for a few years and stuff like that. So I mean, as coaches, we're natural teachers.
Right. Right.
But you know, so I did all those years of coaching and teaching, and it came to a point where I was like, okay, I've got to do my own thing. You know, I have all these years of education.
Right.
And here, let me put a website together for the questions that the people ask the most.
Right, right.
And so I'm slowly putting together, you know, modules and teaching things where people ask me the most. And it's like, these kids are all over. They want coaching. So in my thing, it's either for coaches, it's for athletes, it's for all that. We have, you know, the community board's a huge thing for me. So that's what I hope a lot of people will sign up for, because it's just a place to discuss like the technical aspects of track.
Okay.
There's no right or wrong of it. It's free. Right.
Just discussion. You know?
So, yeah. And so about twice a week, I try to post something on there and, you know,
get,
you know, just people to look and, you know, and I've had we're about 2 months in, and we have about 40 something coaches signed up for the subscription thing. And
okay.
I mean, there's thousands of drills, hundreds and hundreds of videos.
Man.
You know, you can do workouts, you can watch education videos, you can watch everyday videos. And that was the design of it. And it's just, you know, it's that thing to, there's a need for it and people want the masses. And for a long time, it was hard for me to monetarily charge for something like that, because I feel bad for, you know.
Because you just want to get it out there.
Yeah. But I've been giving stuff out since 2005. So I figured like, okay, I've been giving stuff out for 16 years. It's okay to like, you know, really put something together, put time into it, and allow people to pay for that. So
for sure.
Yeah.
No, that's good. I think I've been talking to a bunch of people about this, because I just watched a video the other day about pricing products and stuff like that, and how pricing something higher actually like makes your product better for multiple reasons. But one of them being like, you know, you feel like you're giving something or you're valuing it where it's actually at. And then also like, when you get money coming in, you can put that money towards making it a better product too.
Well, exactly. And my thing is like, I put it at a pricing where, okay, if a high school kid wanted to follow workouts and design workouts, every kid can afford $100 a month.
Right.
I mean, there's not a kid, I mean, with the things they buy, like their phones and their shoes and everything else, $100 is not a bad price to be coached by a coach who's coached medalists and everything else and get those workouts, plus thousands and thousands of videos, plus, you know, tens and tens of thousands of dollars I paid on my own coaching education to learn and get better and travel and everything else like that. And so I figured $100 was a good pricing thing. And even for coaches, it's like, you don't, you know, it's a month thing. So if after a month you think it sucks, you know, don't sign up for it anymore.
Right. But right. Yeah.
If it's good for 4 or 5 months and you're cool with that, then sign it up that way. So, you know, I just felt like that was a very good pricing. I mean, a lot of people told me I should charge more, but I didn't want to make it, you know, unaffordable for, you know, the high school kid or athlete or something who doesn't have a coach, but has, you know, wants to get better.
Right. Learn. Yeah, for sure. Big time.
So
did you, I mean, it kind of seems this way, because your trajectory was kind of just going that way when I forget who recommended that you start coaching.
So, well, it was funny. I was, you know, fully set on going to med school and, you know, going into getting a master's degree and going in that direction. And Ed Nuttycombe was like, hey, you want to come out and help the track program? You're here, you're training, whatever.
Yeah.
And I'm like, sure. And after 2 weeks, I was like, oh, freaking, I love this. This is amazing. Yeah, yeah. Like, this is what I want to do.
This is the thing.
And so, you know, my first job, I made $2,000. Not a month. Yeah, yeah. Not for for the year, I made $2,000.
Right, right.
And, you know, even 1 year, I worked for free, you know, at Wisconsin in, yeah, in between years. So, you know, I laugh because these kids start off at $40,000, $50,000 and they're pissed, you know, like, oh, I don't make that much. And they're trying to always get the next job.
Yeah.
And, you know, I made $2,000 my first year, probably like 10 my second, or 20 maybe my second. And then I made 40 finally after my third or fourth year, after already having a national champion and everything. My right, first, right. You know, is 3 years in and or 4 years in, and I'm making $40,000. And, you know, and I committed 4 years to there. And then I took the next job at Oklahoma. And Oklahoma, I made good money. I don't even know, with the camp and everything else. I mean, I don't mind sharing. It's like,
sure,
I probably made between $60,000 and $80,000 every year I was in Norman, you know, nice, which was good money. And yeah, we won two conference championships, and, you know, the women finished fourth at nationals. And, yeah, you know, so we really built something there after not winning anything for like 28 years or something like that.
Wow. Wow.
You know, you know, it was just always kind of one of those things where I fell in love with it. And then once I fell in love with it, I was going to be the best coach I could be. Mm-hmm. So that was like getting all my certifications, getting all my education. Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm a coaching nerd. That's what I do. So most people, they were going on vacation to the Bahamas or whatever with their girlfriend or whatever. I was going to Germany to go spend 5 days with Wolfgang Ritzdorf. I went on vacation. I went to Brazil and spent 4 days with Nelio Moura. And, you know, I went to Belgium and got to work, you know, spend 24 hours with Franz Bosch. And, yeah, and me being the high level athlete probably opened a lot of doors,
right, right,
that a lot of other, because they knew me from jumping, mm-hmm, or, mm-hmm, you know, because of connections I had, and yeah, they gave me the time of day, I guess. But that's what I did for vacation. I learned from people, you know, I mean, obviously we learned from Boo and Dan and everybody within, sure, the US.
Sure.
But for me, I got to a point where I was also like, yeah, let me learn from these other coaches that are not typical,
yeah,
of what we're doing. So, you know, like, it's funny, Klaus Bernitz, he's here and he coaches the Indian javelin thrower, Chopra.
Okay.
Yep. And they're training at the center. I met him years ago because I ended up going to be with Wolfgang. And Klaus was there, and Klaus was like, you know, longtime strength and conditioning guy and,
yeah,
and, you know, thrower, like, he was the head of strength and conditioning for a lot of Germany.
Okay.
So I ended up spending like a day with him, and it's funny, jeez, it's full circle, because now he's back and he's like, you coached more medalists than I have, you know, and kind, yeah, of thing. And so, it's cool, just, you know, it's kind of funny, but, you know, he's a phenomenal coach and a great kind of resource. And then being at the center has been huge. I mean, you know, I mean, I'll be out of practice. And, you know, when I first got here, I'm out there and I get to spend time with, you know, Yannick Chigaro, who's got, and he coached Caroline Clough and he coached Christian Olsen.
Oh, okay.
Yep. And, you know, so I'm just talking to him about, yeah, stuff. Yeah. And he's phenomenal. And he's got now a new young group. He coaches Tobias.
Yep.
Yeah. Motler. And he's a phenomenal coach. I get to talk to him. Michelle Tornius and his coach came out, so I get to hang out with him. And, yeah, and I mean, even not in like, for years, Anita, I can't even say her last name, but the Polish world record holder and the hammer comes out, and her coach comes out, and I just get to talk to him, you know, yeah, just about strength and
yeah,
things. And it's just, I mean, it's so many. I mean, I know, not just because of track, but Renal Lavaline comes out with his coach and I get to talk to his coach, you know, on, yeah, end, and, you know, and Bob Kersey's here and Brooks Johnson. And so it just, once I got to the center, like, I was like, dang, I have access to all these international coaches on a, yeah, yearly basis. And so, yeah, I just, it opened my mind even more, and, mm-hmm, I got, mm-hmm, to learn even more as a coach.
What's one thing or a couple of things that surprised you or that were like totally brand new concepts when you were doing that kind of circuit of like going to Brazil and going to Germany to meet these other coaches?
So I learned the strength basis, and, you know, it kind of ticked some people off in the US system and stuff like that, but when our strength system is so based on power and strength power,
Okay.
And there is this thing called speed power, you know?
And, there's a difference.
Yeah, there's definitely a difference. I mean, cool. there's a strength power where we're, you know, looking at 60, 65%. We're trying to move it as fast as we can. Okay. But then we're looking at, you know, at speed power. It's like looking at something like 30, 40% of our 1 RM and also moving that super fast, right?
Okay.
And so it's the speed of movement changes with the difference in the weight and how much moving. And so for them, it was really the specificity of movement, because we have generalities. So we sit there and we, you know, have our squat. We'll have, like, you know, it's like you talk and, you know, it's like such a heated topic to talk about squatting, and we'll talk about full squats and everything else. And that's the first time I ever learned a quarter squat with 110% of our 1 RM, because, you know, you can do a quarter squat, but that's the angles we see when we're jumping or sprinting or something like that. Yeah. And so it's just kind of like, oh, wow. You know, and ours is, I think we stop at a generality of strength conditioning. There's not a lot of coaches who do that. And then the Europeans do a lot of specificity towards their technique thing. So like the US, we may do power cleans and we'll do squats and we're getting better. We're getting a lot better. Don't get me wrong. But 20 years ago, it was like a quarter squat was like a waste of time. And you had to do a full squat and all that kind of stuff, like or a half squat or something like that. And that's about as much as we did. Hmm. Now you can do quarter squats and you're looking at angles and knees. You can do like a hang high pull, you know, like a box high pull kind of clean or something. That stuff wasn't, I mean, Olympic lifters maybe a little bit, but we really based it, a lot of our strength stuff, on Olympic lifters and power lifters and stuff like that. Sure. And now there's a lot of adaptations for track athletes. And so the creativity in the European and some of the other thing was really big, where the US was very vanilla.
Okay.
And so that's the biggest thing I learned, is the specificity of strength training and specificity of training for the event.
Wow. That's crazy.
But so, because they have less resources. So in the US, you've got what, 15 guys who jump 8 meters. Okay. Right.
Yeah.
And so it's just like whoever the cream rises to the top, and it is what it is. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, you've got this unbelievable kind of like minor league system with the junior, with NCAA.
Yeah.
I mean, look, you got freaking, you know,
Javon.
The LSU, Javon. You got LSU. You got freaking the kids at Florida State. You got kids at Tennessee. I mean, you got all these great potential. I know those are Jamaicans, but the point being is there's, you know, kids who are going to come up who are American through the system. And then it's like, whoever jumps 8:30, we'll take them and we'll support them.
Yeah.
There, you know, like Michelle Tornius was a perfect example. Michelle Tornius didn't jump 8 meters till he was like 25, 26 years old.
Yeah. Yeah.
In the US, he would have been done with the sport 5, 6 years before that. Right.
Right. Yeah.
And so he ended up being fourth at the Olympics, multi-time, whatever, but he didn't actually start to really find a lot of success till he was 28 to 30, 31, 32 years old. Yep. And in the US system, he would have never did that, but they put all those resources in him and showed him specificity of training and got him to the long games, and Michelle had a fantastic career. He had a phenomenal career.
Yeah.
But in the US, he wouldn't have made it.
Man. Yeah. I think about that a lot. So I was like a 25-foot long jumper, but that's nothing, you know, in the US. It's just like, okay. But if I would have lived in like Sweden, or maybe not even Sweden now, because those guys are beasts, but you know, like,
But they only have one. Like they have two, because the other guy, he got hurt. But they have like probably have like 2 8-meter guys, and maybe they have a junior guy. But the point being is they have room for a guy who can jump 760.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? And hopefully develop him to be 8 meters. But they will exhaust, as long as you want to do it, they will exhaust their resources to try to get you to jump 8 meters.
Yeah.
And it may happen when you're 27, 28 years old, because you're not truly a man or a woman, and you're not at your full development until you're 26, 27 years old.
Yep.
So, but the college system is basically you're done at 22, 23, you'll maybe try it a year after, like scrimping and saving and starving.
Yeah.
And then you're just like, okay, I want to live my life.
Yeah.
Instead of being like, okay, I can support myself till I'm 30 to do this. And then at 30, I can, because if you think about it in the long term of thing, you start sport at 12 and you end it, that's only 18 years of your life. If you live till you're 85 years old, you're going to have 55 years without sport.
Yep.
You know, and so it's like I tell athletes, like, hey, if you love it and you can afford to do it, keep doing it. I don't care if you're jumping 6 meters or you're jumping 8 meters. You know, if you love it, keep doing it.
That's awesome. I love that. All right. So what are your responsibilities at the Olympic Training Center, and what's your role, title, whatever?
Well, at one time I was like the lead for coaching education for both IAAF or World Athletics and USA Track and Field, but I've kind of stepped back away from those roles. Basically, right now I'm just the director of the residence program at the training center, and I'm the lead coach. Okay. And, you know, just coach, you know, coach a long time, Brittany Reese, Will Clay, Gator Orji, Chris Bernard, Brian McBride, just on and on and on. And then I help anybody who comes through, you know, like for about a month before trials, Quanisha Burks trained with me just because, you know, Boo was busy and they were busy with NCAA. So she came for three weeks. I help foreign countries. So Wu, who finished fourth at the Olympics, Wu Sung Wook, who finished fourth at the Olympics. I actually coach him and train him. So he trains with me.
In Chula. Virtually.
Okay. No, in Chula.
Wow,
in Chula.
Okay.
And then I go to Korea maybe once or twice a year, work with them. But yeah, they just left. They were just here for like a month, and they're in Europe for like a month or two, and then they'll come back after World Indoors. But I work with Morgan Lake, who's a really she's been with me for the last 2 months out here training with me. So I'll work with some athletes. Mainly it's the American athletes, and that's who I work with. And then I'll get some foreign athletes from here and there, like Aprender Singh. He was with me for 6 months, a couple years back. Alberto Alvarez was with me for a year, like a couple years back.
Is he still training?
He's training down in Mexico now. Okay. Elvis Misons, who was a Latvian, he trained with me for a year.
Okay.
So, you know, like I had the Korean record holder in the long and triple jump. Diok, he jumped like 820 something and 17 something. But he was like, Will was the only person to qualify for the finals of both the long and triple jump at Worlds in 11. He trained with me at times. And then another one was Unjeju, and he was like 808 when he jumped here. So I work with different jumpers from all over. My main job is I try to work with Paralympic athletes too, so Lex Gillette, Toby
Sweet,
Fawahimi, Trenton Merrill, who's the you know, American record holder in the below the knee amputee. So Paralympics, able body, and then I get some foreign athletes that work here too. So I try not to get my group bigger than 10 people, but that's usually what I get and get out here.
Sure. So with your training groups that you have, like, I mean, you said, it sounds like a lot of people kind of just like filter in and out.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, you know, they come through for a period of time, you train, and then you go. How do you approach it? Because, like, you know, you're not writing an entire training plan for them.
Exactly.
You're like, okay, where are you at right now? What can I do to get you a little better? Yeah.
So that's exactly how it is. So you're not trying to bury the athletes. So when they come in, depending what they need at different times. So like when Eric Kennard came out last year, you know, we really worked hard for him to get to jump 230. And I swear, I thought he was going to jump 233. And it was, you know, it was collaboration with his coach, you know, Cliff for Velto, and just, you know, work with Eric and say, this is what we need, be a set of eyes and think, okay, let's make adaptations here and there. And that's the best we can do. And so that's what a lot of times what I work with the athletes, and I'm like, you know, like, okay, let's work on this and focus in on this. And we're just going to target that for the next, you know, month while you're here. And that's what we're going to focus on. So you can take those things away and keep working on it and so forth like that. So, you know, we've had athletes all over. I mean, Jasmine Sawyer was here, even though she works in Lance, but she was here for like 2 weeks or so. And her issue was she was dropping her knees into her takeoff. So it's like, just keep your running form up. Let's keep our thighs up. Keep running tall on her hips through takeoff. And then she ended up jumping 690 something at our place. And then she took that, and, you know, she had a very successful summer too.
Yeah.
And so it was just, you know, I'm just trying to give them little, you know, things here and there so that they can, you know, kind of progress when they do. And again, it's not an ego thing. I don't want credit for it. I'm just trying to help the athlete.
Exactly. Yep. So a question about that though, like, so do you have athletes who are like proper your athletes? And I know that it's kind of flexy.
For sure.
You have like your athletes and I don't know the right way to say this, but like how, where is the ownership? Because, you know, like they're a professional as well, you know, choosing to work with you. Like, okay, in high school and college, you know, mm-hmm. your coach is your coach. You listen exactly. to what he says. You don't make a lot of the decisions. Yeah. As professionals, I think they have the right to, you know, make those decisions themselves. Sure. How much of that, how much of your athletes' decisions are you versus them?
Okay. So the word and the, you know, kind of thing that we talked about and you're talking about is ownership and yeah. onus. Okay. And that, okay. and that on the athlete. Okay. Yeah. And so you can lead that a little bit into buy-in and you can sure. lead that into, just having the athlete has to have buy-in and yep. ownership of what they're doing. So if I take look at it from an avenue in high school and college, I tend to be the captain of the ship. Okay. And yeah. you're just kind of like yeah. on the ship and I'm leading the ship wherever it goes.
Right.
At the post-collegiate level, at my view, I am the navigator and you're mm-hmm. the captain. So you determine where you're competing, where you do it. Obviously I'm the navigator. So I'm trying to make sure you don't run into any icebergs yep. or you have enough gas or yeah. you have enough, you're the rudder's going the right direction, them. All those. Exactly. Yep. And that's my job as a post-collegiate coach. And so, cool. yes, I mean, Will and I, when I coached him in college, it was a dictatorship. I told him what, I told him when, I told yeah. him where and whatever. And since now, like basically Will can coach himself.
Okay.
And yeah. Will right. has probably, Will and I meet, we talk, all my athletes talk, and I want them to interject and have,
yes.
You know, like buy back into what forth. We're trying yep. to do. Right. So the hard part is like for Katora last year, even though she had a successful year, we expected yeah. bigger things, right? Mm. We expected, mm-hmm. you know, potentially, I mean, she is very much capable of having being medalist at right. the games.
Right.
But that's the first year kind of thing is like, I did things that probably wasn't the best for her.
Okay.
And she being so respectful as an athlete didn't want to sit there and say, well, coach, I think we should be doing this.
Sure.
So now we're in our second year. And for me, it's not disrespectful. It's like you right. have buy-in, you have
responsibility,
ownership and, you know, an onus yeah. in your training. So mm-hmm. I want you to talk to me and say, hey, coach, I like to do this drill or I want to do this instead of this.
Yeah.
And to me, it's not questioning my coaching. It's making sure that you know what works for you. And so right. that's the bigger thing at the collegiate level. The longer we work with, so I've been working with Will since he was 17. We've been yeah. working with each other for 14 years now.
That's crazy.
Or 13 years now. And this yeah. is our 14th year. So like, he'll tell me, coach, let's do this weight thing instead of that thing. So when I'm writing yeah. weight things, like he'll interject some of the stuff, or sometimes on yeah. the track, he'll interject some of the stuff. Same with Chris, mm-hmm. you know, Brittany was one of those, like, I don't want to know, just like, let's do this.
Tell me, let's
I'll
do
just
it.
Jump part. Yeah. yeah. And things like that. So yeah. different people for different things, but you know, definitely at this level, I want more, you know, buy-in from the athlete yeah. and I want them to be interject as much as possible.
Well, I would say that's probably the most effective approach anyway, because like, you know, you're the coach, you have the knowledge and experience of how the body moves and all that, but you don't know what he's feeling on the inside, you know, like
exactly.
you can see what you can see, but you need that feedback from him to be yeah. able to basically complete the puzzle.
And none of these kids at this level are like, you know, that high school kid who doesn't want to work out. So you got to like be on them or call. I mean, I had college kids who I was like, yeah. I can't believe that you're just, you know, like punching your clock and you're not actually committed to mm-hmm. what you're doing.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we're still successful. And I had kids that were all Americans who were that way.
Right.
But you know, it was always kind of like, man, if you really sat there and gave what it could have been, what could you really be?
Right.
And so at this level, I don't have those kids anymore. Everybody mm-hmm. wants to be here right, and everybody right. wants to try to be the best they can be. So,
that's awesome.
You know, they ask more questions, they have more buy-in and they're, right. you know, and you know, again, because of that, you know, so here's for example, so Isaiah Griffith, he's one of my new kids, right? And we'll talk. It'll be like, hey, you know, we have six reps and I'll coach, do you want me to do all six? And I'll be like, well, I'm going to watch you and see how you are. And, oh, okay. We just finished our fourth rep. I'm done. I like what I see. We're done there. Let's keep you healthy.
Yeah.
And so, you know, and, but it's much more a dictatorship. Or with Keturah, it's like, you know, like she's kind of in between where she wants to listen to a lot of stuff. She wants to interject a little bit of her stuff, but she's, you know, kind of there. And then with Will, it's like, I want him to interject all the time and I want him to be much more of a writer of his training and so forth like that.
Yeah. I feel like a good athlete or like the ideal athlete is one who is learning along with, you know, being taught. And so then it should be to the point, like you said, after 14 years or whatever with Will Clay, like he basically knows you, you kind of are like this like malleable unit, but still as you're learning and informing new things with him and, you know, that's cool.
And you have to, because the longer you work with athletes, I mean, you'll see some coaches who are great coaches, phenomenal coaches.
Yeah.
You got about a 2 or 3 year window with them because they have a system and everyone has to be in their system.
Oh.
And then after a certain while, like, you know, the collegiate kids don't get better or, you know, even their post-collegiate, they don't do well.
Yeah.
And it's because they have a system and they, because there's no new stimulus or there's no, you know, looking at certain things that may be shortcomings of that athlete, they don't do well post-collegiately. And so you can look at it. I mean, you just watch a trajectory of an athlete and, you know, they'll do really well in college and they may struggle a year or two after.
Yeah.
And it's not because the athlete lost their ability. If there's no catastrophic injury, if a girl ran 10.98 in college and she's now running 11.2 she didn't get hurt, it's not because she, you know, I don't believe that she's not trying any harder. She's not whatever. But if you're not giving that person a new stimulus or changing their training and working on different things, then they're not going to get better.
Yeah.
So I think part of that, having that back and forth is making sure you're addressing those things. And most of my athletes I have for a long time.
Yeah, that's awesome. And a big point of respect, I think, for me and a lot of people in the community for you, too.
I appreciate that.
Because, this triple jump, as you know, not easy on the body. So
no, I mean, long jump's not easy on the body. Triple jump's not easy on the body. I mean, high jump, it really isn't. I mean, it done improperly, you know, it can be very taxing to the body.
Sure. Okay, so you probably can't have favorites, but do you have a favorite event to coach? I know you were a high jumper.
Gosh, people ask me that. It's so hard. I hate to say it because it's like, you know, long jump is just, I can run fast and kind of whatever. And, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah.
High jump, I almost can like close my eyes. I can watch someone land in the pit, see nothing else and tell you almost what they did wrong.
No way.
And the triple jump, I feel like because it was my weakest event, I probably have spent the most time watching videos and learning it and getting better. Because I was only like a 49 foot something triple jumper, even college, and I get it to score points once in a while. But
that video you posted of yourself triple jump.
Yeah, I mean, that was bad. That was high school. That was like 45 something, which is crazy. Just you're 44 or
pure,
something.
Pure talent.
Yeah. I hate to say it because it's like, I love the high jump because obviously that's my thing, but I really like the triple jump and I love the beauty of the triple jump when it's done right and stuff like that. And, you know, if I could sit there and say like internationally, people sat there and said, okay, well, you know, obviously Jeremy Fischer is a great jumps coach, but I mean, I obviously had Brittany and I've had, other people who've been successful. I mean, I've had, I don't know how many national champions in the long jump.
Right.
You know, triple jump, high jump is my weakest one. I mean, I helped Jamie and I helped Brian McBride and that's about it. You know, I have two really, and Ricky Robertson. So, I mean, I have people, Olympians, and I have national champions and I have people on Team USA who finished finalists and stuff. But triple jump is just that, I guess, the event where like, it's hard. I mean, Brittany's such a freaking talent. It's just hard because she makes anybody look good. Yeah. But, there's something about the artistry of the triple jump that just kind of like, I honestly have to say, gives me a little bit more, kind of heart stuff like that. But then I watch Rojas do it and go, I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. He's freaking towing 15.62. I'm like, what the hell?
Yeah.
You know, it's like the worst form, short approach, toeing off the step and jumping 15.62. And, you know, and I'm just like, well, maybe I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. I don't know.
No, she's a freak. I'm
sure
she
is. She
more,
is.
I mean, more conversations have been had about her form than anybody else in all
professional. I mean, and she's 6'4". I mean, you can't coach that. My goodness. So
yeah, she's not slow either. So
no. And she's not as 11 meters. I don't care what anybody says. She's not 11 meters per second. You can't tell me. You can't tell me she's fast. 11 meters was faster than Javon and 95% of the long jumpers.
Oh, okay.
She's not that
right,
fast.
Right, right. Yeah.
Like, she's fast. I'm not going to give you, I mean, 10 meters per second is fast.
Yeah. Yep.
But they had her at 11 meters per second in the Olympics. I'm like, those numbers are
something
wrong.
Was wrong with the men.
Yeah. Cause even Katura, they had Katura at 10 something. And I'm like, I measure Katura all the time. And even when she's jumping well, she's at like 9.5, 9.6. And I think they had her up as almost close to 9.8, 9.9. And I'm like,
and you don't think adrenaline had that big of a impact?
No. I mean, you know, if she would have been 9.7, 9.6, I'd have believed it because that's about where she's at, you know, and stuff like that. But having her at like 9.8 and having Roas at 11 was like just the thing that I was like, okay, these numbers are off. The math is off. They computed something wrong. Because if you're telling, I mean, that means she's faster than Will, and I'll take Will every day of the week over Roas in a 30, 40, and 60 meter sprint, you know.
Right. Yeah.
So there's no way she's beating Will. I mean, Will's a 10.
Yeah.
I think his PR is 10:42 in legal, and we don't run it when he's running good, but he's probably
going to say
he could probably run 10:28, 10:29. If Ross can run 10:28, then I'll freaking, then she doesn't need to triple jump. She needs to go run the 100.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong. I'm not disrespecting Ross. I'm just saying that they did was wrong. And those numbers at the Olympics were completely wrong.
For sure. Okay. Did Katura or Will say that runway felt particularly fast, or is it just...
No, I don't think so. I would say Katura was at the Olympics with a little bit of injury. We didn't let know that, but she actually kind of had a tib-fib kind of injury going into the Olympics, unfortunately. So she's probably at 90%, and she'll never, you know, she's such a strong athlete that, I mean, yes, she finished seventh and she jumped 14:59, but she probably was only at about 85-90% of her ability, which kind of sucks.
What's her PB?
14:92.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Yeah, which would have been a silver medal or a bronze medal or something
or
something.
For sure.
And she was injured. And then Will was probably at 90% just because he wasn't back from his Achilles tear all the way.
Right. Yeah.
And so, like, you know, so yeah, the numbers weren't what we were. I mean, if Will 100% is from coming back from 19 without any injury, you know, then he probably would be, and I don't see him not jumping over 18 meters at the Olympics. But 17:44 coming off Achilles injury was pretty freaking impressive.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, you could just tell he wasn't there, you know, like
we didn't have enough. Yeah. We just ran out of time with him and stuff. Right. And so, you know, the only one but I mean, you know, and Brittany, obviously, just, you know, you can't complain about a silver, but, you know, she had it till the 9th hour or 11th hour. And
I mean, it wasn't overly.
We weren't excited. I mean, like, even when Westerface jumped 7 meters, I didn't think that was 7 meters because she jumped so far behind the board. So I have to give her respect. And I was just waiting for Brittany to pop one. I really thought she was going to jump over 7:10. And so I was just waiting for it. And so when she didn't, it was kind of like, well, what just happened?
Yeah.
It was kind of weird.
It was weird. I mean, like, nobody jumped really far though, you know, like,
no.
Yeah. So
no, it was weird. It was a weird competition for sure.
Yeah. Man.
Yeah.
Got a strange cough going on right here.
No, that's okay. Probably because of that minus weather out there.
yeah. Okay. So back to, Olympic training centers and coaching anyway. Do you pick your athlete schedules or do they kind of decide?
No, we collaborate. Just like
just a collaboration.
We collaborate. So yeah. We look and see what works. Like, we know that, like, you know, indoors, like Katura is going to jump, and we work with the agents, different agents I work with. So he's going to long jump at Melrose because they don't have triple jump. And then we're going to triple jump one time at New Mexico.
Okay.
Because that's just like a couple weeks before USA's. She wanted to jump one time before USA's, and then she'll jump at USA's, and she'll She'll triple jump as long as it's before. She'll triple jump, and then as long as long jumps after triple jump, she'll double. But okay. If it long jumps before triple jump, then we'll just concentrate on the triple.
Yeah,
and then we'll go to worlds and obviously triple at worlds. Okay. And then for Chris, we're not gonna do indoors. We're just gonna focus in on outdoors unless he just decides to change his mind. But
yeah,
our plan is to get ready for Eugene this summer.
Okay.
And Chris is going to jump at the New Balance. And Isaiah and Chris will jump at the New Balance meet on February 6th.
Okay.
And at the Seabreeze Complex and stuff like that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so they'll so that'll be that. And then the only other meet we'll do is USA's and then Worlds. So it'll be a short little indoor schedule.
Yeah. Nice. So, what do you think? Who do you think's going to go for the US?
On the men's side?
Yeah, for long and triple.
Long jump. I don't know who'll jump indoors. I mean, obviously, if Dendy and Harrison, Javon mm-hmm. and then the Texas kid, I can't think of his name. You know, who made the Olympic team? I'm having a brain fart on his name. You know, the three Olympians who made the Olympic team. So Dendy, Javon, Harrison. If Jeff Henderson decides to jump, I think, you know, the long jump is going to be very competitive. I mean, it'll be, and the triple jump, I mean, it's the same cast of characters. I mean, it's going to be, if Will decides to jump or not jump, then it'll be between Donald Scott, Chris Bernard, Chris Carter, and then I really think Isaiah will do something too. So it'll
Chris
be between
Carter's
those.
Still jumping?
I don't know if he'll jump indoors. I think he'll jump outdoors. I mean, Chris had the best jump at the Olympic trials last year. It was a toe foul, but it was jump.
Okay.
Yeah, it was the best jump. So I don't know. He's teaching and everything, and I assume he's going to jump, but he does sometimes he jumps well indoors. So I don't know what he's going to do, but I think Chris Carter, Chris Bernard, Donald, and one of those, I mean, it'll be between those four guys, obviously.
Are there any other like on the girls' side or women's side?
I mean, well, they won't because Jasmine Moore is still in college, so she won't jump at Worlds. She'll jump at NCAAs and stuff. Sure. And I mean, Amani Oliver is talented, so she could. But I mean, I really feel like Keturah, you know, she jumped she only did one meet in 19 and jumped 14.62, and then Tori Pastor jumped 64 to set the American record. And so. You know, I know Keturah wants to jump over 1470 indoors. And so I think it'll be her and Tori. Tori's already got the free pass to Worlds because she won the thing last year, like the World Tour thing.
Oh, okay.
So it would be just, I mean, so there's only one spot. So, I mean, obviously they'd have to beat Keturah to make the team and jump over 1430 or whatever it is.
Yeah.
So. I'm not saying that there's a couple women who don't have the ability to do it. They do, but I think it's going to – because Tori's already got the pass, I think you're going to have to jump over 1450, and I just don't see another American woman doing that.
Sure. Okay.
So, yeah.
All right. So give us some insight into professional coaching. So, like, you work with sponsorships and brands and stuff like that. Give us some insights into that world. What's that
so,
like?
I mean, it's hard for a professional track coach. It really is. Now,
for a professional track coach,
yes,
not period. Even just the athletes,
I'm not saying the coach who's kind of in a college setting. I'm talking about the professional coaches like myself or like a Dan Path back in the day or a Raina Ryder or people like that.
Yeah.
So if you're not sponsored by a shoe company. Like Raina is sponsored by Puma, Dan or I'm trying to think of another coach, like Bobby Kersey, a long time was sponsored by Nike and what's his name? Lance Brom is sponsored by Adidas. So they're paid by Adidas, right?
Okay.
And they're in the sprints. So for the sprints event, the athletes get paid fairly well. And the jumps, like if I was a professional coach and I was not paid by USA Track and Field, I couldn't afford to be a track coach if I didn't do anything else.
Right.
Because jumpers don't get paid those kind of sponsorships.
Yeah.
And so like for a jumper to get a six figure contract is very rare.
Hmm.
And that means they probably have multiple medals at the world and Olympic level.
Yeah.
Right. And any athlete, you know, just, and I'm not trying to shoot people down, but that sure. college kid who comes out as NCAA champion and thinks, oh, I'm going to sign this big contract, you better be a medal viable candidate yeah. who's okay. going to medal that next year. And you better medal in your opportunity, or your contract, if you do get one, is going to be peanuts on the dollar. And you're not going to be able to afford to pay a coach and so forth like that. So,
yeah.
you know, for so it's hard. I mean, you either have to have a big, large group. Because even $500 is hard for a coach, for an athlete. I mean, a coach of our level, the going rate is between $2,500 and $5,000 for a professional athlete, for a professional track coach. And there's very few per month.
Oh, okay.
And there's very few, and that's even, you know, less. I mean, you know, I know some coaches who make $90,000-$100,000 for coaching one athlete.
Wow.
Right.
Yeah.
Because they're paid by the federation. So 25 to 5,000, even at one athlete, 25,000 or 2,500 a month is only 25,000. So you'd have to have, you know, and you have to pay for travel and all that kind of stuff. So you'd have to have a minimum of, you know, probably 6-7 athletes to financially go, because you're going to cost $30,000-$40,000 in travel a year,
man,
traveling with your athletes and stuff
do,
like that.
Do you travel to like all the meets?
Yeah, I usually travel 150-180,000 miles a year, which is just exhausting. Yeah.
I can imagine.
And so I'm lucky I have an assistant, Bashir, who will travel a lot of times for me, because I try to limit. But I mean, perfect example, I go to Melrose, I'm back, and then I'm back to the Seabreeze, and then I'm back. Then we go to New Mexico, then I'm back, and then I'll have the weekend off, and then we'll go to USA's, and then I have a couple weekends off, and then we'll go to World. So, I mean, just in that, I'm gone
right,
you know, 6 out of the 9 or 8 weekends of indoors. And then outdoors, I love it, because we don't go very far.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, that's the life of a, and then you've got to be able to make money to coach your athletes. And, I mean, the jumpers don't make that like that. Sprinters, sometimes a little bit easier, but there's not a lot of post-collegiate groups. I mean, if you look at jumps-wise, I know – Dwight, I have mine. Dwight Phillips has his, and then most of the other ones are all through college coaches.
Yeah.
As a college coach, you're not, you know, you're paid by the college. So being a post collegiate is not a priority, right?
Right. Yeah.
So, you can't name that many jumps groups. The throws groups, I can name maybe 3. I know there's one out in, like throw one deep or something like that. It's out in Georgia. And then there's Ryan Whiting's group in Arizona. And then obviously the training center.
Yeah.
So there's very few field event groups and stuff. And most of them, the other ones, like Deanna Price, coached by her husband, who's also a college coach.
Right.
You know, Raven Saunders, she worked at coached at Alabama, who's a college coach, you know, before she worked here. You know, Ryan, I mean, but you look at it, Raven, Ryan, Darrell Hill, Joe Kovacs, they all came through the center first.
Yeah.
And then they breed it off. So the center has been a great place for throwers to develop and then establish themselves and go out. And same with you know, I mean, like jumper wise Dendy trains with Nick at Florida, or you've got you know, Javon with Boo and Todd at LSU and so on and so forth. So those are all college coaches, but there's very, very small little groups, rare groups that have jumpers only, because they just can't afford to survive.
Right. So is it different in other countries, like you were saying before, because they have like a federation or some sort of like bigger organization?
They see the value of the athlete, and there's so much fewer of them that they'll pay accordingly. So, you know, like without putting my information out there, I'll get paid by, you know, Korean Federation to work with the Korean athletes, you know, and it's funny because, like, you know, not that I have a bad job, I have a good job and I'm paid well and, you know, whatever, but if you look from collegiately, I'm way underpaid compared to what college directors would be paid and stuff like that.
At
a big time Division I college, I mean, those coaches should make it $250,000-$300,000. I mean, you know, you look at the coaches at like Oregon and they're all making over $300,000
for track and field
directors in track and field. All those Power Five schools, I bet you half of them make over $250,000.
Did not know that.
Yep.
Wow. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Huh. So have you thought about doing that, or do you like,
you got to deal with so much other stuff. I respect them, but like, I want to coach.
Yep.
And, you know, just you. Like, I know Robert Johnson at Oregon is so busy being a director that it's probably really hard for him to coach.
Sure.
You know, yeah. Pat Henry is so busy being the director at Texas A&M. It's very hard for him to coach. You know, I mean, not saying that, you know, and they do good jobs, but I'm just saying that it's a very time managing hard thing for them to do. And, you know, they're probably up at 7 every day and get home, work till 9 and talking to recruits and everything else. And I get to coach. I'm on the track from 10:30 till 5 o'clock every day.
In perfect 75 and sunny
weather. Exactly.
Hard to
beat that. I'll give up the, you know, couple hundred thousand and they're making more than me or whatever.
Yeah.
To, you know, live a very comfortable, good, solid life and enjoy what I do.
Awesome.
For sure.
Sweet.
For sure.
So you don't regret going the coaching route then?
No, not at all. And awesome. I don't regret leaving college, which is a big question a lot of coaches have. They're like, do you regret leaving college? Not in the first bit.
Not at all.
Not the least bit. No, not That's at all. Awesome. Not at all.
Okay. All right. So as a professional coach, so do you get nervous at meets or do you get nervous for your athletes at meets?
I mean, less and less. I mean, there's two meets that I get nervous at, obviously the trials and the Olympics. I'm pretty nervous, you know, but I mean, early meets I know are billed to the next meet. So I don't get overly nervous. And even at the trials, a lot of times I know that I did everything I could to get that athlete ready. So it's like, it's more like, okay, just let them shine, let them, you know, compete because, you know, like there's nothing more that we could have done.
Yeah.
You know, maybe there was, maybe there isn't, but we're here and this is what we got and this is the best we're going to do. But there's times where everything works out and you're just like, I got these athletes ready. I know they're ready. And it's the best I could do. Like I've had a couple times like that, like 16 trials, 17 US championships, where I just felt like, man, we're really, really ready.
Yeah.
And, you know, and things happen, you know, things, you know, can transpire that are good or things that couldn't happen and stuff. I mean, you know, and then you're left sometimes disappointed, you know, with how things go. So, I mean, you do the best job you can and to best of your ability and get the athletes as well prepared as you can. And I mean, trials and probably Olympics are probably the two world championships. Those are the ones that I get a little nervous for. But, you know, I've been doing it for a while. So,
yeah. You're at least good at faking it.
Exactly. Fake it till you make it. Right.
Yeah. All right. Let's see. All right. Give me just some of your favorite coaching moments. You know, some of the top ones, best places you've been to, best moments where like an athlete really came through in clutch and did some things like that. Just fun moments, things that you think of fondly.
Fun moments. Definitely. I think, in 16 indoors, Brittany Reese, she had, labral surgery and kind of was like almost on the verge of maybe quitting the sport and stuff. Wow. And we came back and on the last jump, she jumped 7:22 and won the meet and won the world championship. And, you know, and Spanovich jumped 7:07 and thought she had won. And she just slammed the door in her face at home in Portland. So that was a good memory. Chris Bernard, jumping, and making the team in 16. Cause he was not even prognosticated to be in the top like 5 or 6.
Okay.
And he ends up making the team and you know, jumping well and doing that. So that was pretty cool. The whole world championships in 17, you know, I thought conditions weren't great, but, Will ended up getting second. Brittany won, the long jump, Brian McBride finished 7th and literally the bar goes like this. And if it falls, it stays on, he wins a medal. And then, Chris, Bernard, he missed the medal by like 3 centimeters and just, you know, if he gets his landing a little bit better, he medals. And so that was just like great. And then, you know, going back to college, you know, I had, you know, a kid who won the national championship, for the first time. That was pretty exciting. And just, you know, seeing athletes PB and do better than they ever thought they could. So that's a lot of fun. You know, I remember first time I had a 55-foot triple jumper was Chardé Boutte at Oklahoma.
Okay.
And he jumped 55 feet and that was kind of cool. Or
Tony
Smith at 12 or 8? I think 8 trials, he jumped 13.99. And, you know, and that was pretty awesome too. So
13.99?
Yeah, she jumped 13.99.
I was like,
she jumped 13.99 and ended up finishing like Yeah, that was pretty cool. So just like little things like that. And I mean, there's so many different things. I mean, I had a kid who won juniors, who was a walk-on high jumper at Oklahoma.
Yeah.
You know, and ended up making the team. Just, you know, Kevin Snyder. So it was just, I've had so many great, I mean, I've been doing it for such a long time.
Right.
You know, go back days at Northridge and, you know, Jason Romero and all these other athletes, you know, and Alex Marbley, and just, you know, all 23 years of coaching, you know, you have great memories and, you know, just when an athlete can achieve, that's just awesome.
For sure.
And it makes you teary eyed and, you know, and just, it's like what you do it for.
That's great. For sure. Well, I mean, it's clear you love coaching and you're obviously in the right profession. So
yeah,
we appreciate the time and investment that you've made to make yourself better and make other athletes better too.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. So last, we'll do like three questions into one.
Okay.
What's your current focus right now? You know, with your work at the Olympic Training Center and MBA services. And then what's your like next 5-10 years and what's your kind of hope for a legacy of Jeremy Fischer?
Well, I mean, like MBA services is my opus. So it's slowly evolving and building, and it's like all this 23 years of coaching, and it continue to evolve over the next couple of years. So it's just to get as much information out there. Really the goal of it is to build it into a big track and field community where sprints, hurdles, everything, and you know, provide services for people who need it. But the big thing is the philanthropic thing. So financially, you know, I'll limit how much I make. I don't, you know, I'm a limit.
Yeah.
And then the goal is then to do free clinics all over the country. So we want to do free clinics in the city. We want to do some in Haiti, do some in Africa. Yeah. No, I mean, that's the goal.
Yeah.
And not just to because it's free, but we're also bringing Olympians, and maybe people don't get the opportunity to meet a Will Clay in Wisconsin or in Detroit or wherever we do it, or Haiti or whatever.
Yeah,
and because that's the goal of it. And to provide kids, you know, a ground floor of like this, and money not to be the object of it.
Yes.
So it's not like, oh, I can't afford the $100 to come to the clinic. I can, you know, it's free.
Yep.
So let's go to it. So that's the big thing for MBA services. And then the training center, you know, it's just, I felt like I've done what I needed to do here. You know, it's not like I'm quitting tomorrow, you know, when we came here, there's very few medals that have been won here.
Wow.
And now we have over 20 medals that have been won by the athletes at the center. And, you know, I've been fortunate enough to coach athletes to 15 myself.
Sheesh.
And so, and then that's the, plus there's probably another 30 or 40 Paralympic medals too.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I felt like you know, it's one of those things, you always want to make something better than before you got it. And I felt like we've done that and we'll continue to do that. And hopefully people see the value and it continues to grow the sport from an athlete standpoint. And that's, and I felt like I've done that. So if I left tomorrow, I felt like I've done a great job for the center. And of course I want to coach the athletes through Paris. And, you know, and that's kind of my short-term goal.
Yeah.
But then the next is obviously to do the stuff for MBA services, be more philanthropic and start to incorporate more of that stuff. So
cool.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wish you best of luck in all that.
Thank you. Thank you for getting the word out and, you know, interviewing me and just
absolutely
kind of my story and see the reason of like, it's not a money grab. It's really to get the information out. And the next thing is to really be able to give more back to the sport eventually.
Right. That's well, we really appreciate good. You doing that right now in this interview. So
yeah, thank you.
Awesome. Well, yeah, we'll get you out of here to your next.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Well, I appreciate you having me on and, you know, please check out MBA services. If you don't want to pay for the paywall, make sure you sign up for the community board. Cause
it's
a great place to discuss track and field and not hide behind a fake name or fake whatever, but put yourself out there, ask good questions and just talk about track, you know?
For sure. Yeah, no, excited to get on there as soon as we're done here. So appreciate it.
Awesome. All right. Yep, take care. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yep, absolutely.
All right. Cheers.
Bye.